Okay, hello. Is this a good voice or a good volume? Is this a good voice? Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Mika. I'm a postdoc working with Julian Hara-Ettinger and Julia Leonard. And this work that I'll be presenting today is also in collaboration with Melissa Santos, our lab manager. Okay, so today I want to start out with this thought, which is that as humans, we often try to motivate each other. We provide words of encouragement like, you can do it, you got this, I believe in you. And by encouragement, what I mean is that we often try to convey confidence in other people's abilities to achieve their goals. And sometimes as we're working on talks for conferences, we receive encouragement from our parents, like, oh no. Okay, I'm not gonna touch that. Okay, we receive encouragement from our parents like this, which is very nice, but the problem is that it doesn't always work. And the question that I'm after today is why? What does make encouragement motivating? And one possibility is that the specific content of the encouragement could really matter here. And this is because we know from work on other types of motivational feedback, like praise, that content might really matter for boosting children's intrinsic motivation. So depending on whether the praise is directed at efforts or abilities, or how inflated or generic it is, each of these features of the content of the feedback can remarkably inform how motivated children are on subsequent tasks. Now, of course, intuitively, who the encouragement comes from might really matter too. And what I'll propose today in this talk is that reasoning about the speaker's knowledge may be particularly important here. So let me give you an example of what I mean. Let's imagine that you're struggling in a difficult cognitive science course at the beginning of a semester, and someone tells you, hey, you can do it. Let's imagine that your instructor and your parent each tell you this. Well, if you think about this, your instructor obviously knows the domain. They know the class well, but they may not know you or your abilities very well at this point in the semester. On the other hand, your parent knows you well, but presumably knows nothing about cognitive science or graduate school courses. And so for both of these people, you might not fully believe their encouragement because they don't have full knowledge of both you and the domain. Now, if your lab mate, who's already taken the course before, says, hey, you got this, then you might really believe them and be motivated to continue in the class. And what we know from past work in cognitive development is that children can represent each of these contents of knowledge. We've learned that children understand that people have expertise in different domains, and they can use these representations of others' knowledge to then evaluate their teaching and decide, for instance, who to approach for information. Now, on the other side, some of my own recent work has shown that children can infer others' knowledge or beliefs about their abilities, and work by Lonnie Bass and colleagues has shown that children can then use these representations to evaluate teachers and interpret their instruction directed at them. Okay, but the question today is whether each of these knowledge representations can inform reasoning about motivational feedback. And the reason that they might is that when people receive encouragement, one possibility of what they're doing is using it to draw a rational inference over how likely it is that they'll succeed on a future task. And so these pieces of knowledge may be particularly informative here. Now, alternatively, it's also possible that what encouragement does is it really only makes people feel good about themselves. These phrases are used so often that they may be really nice to hear, but ultimately uninformative. And if this is the case, then the encouragement may just be taken at face value, and who the speaker is and what they know may not really be relevant here. Okay, so what we're gonna do today is test to what extent each of these matter, and specifically we predict that people will be most likely to seek out and be motivated by encouragement from a speaker with higher knowledge of the domain and knowledge of one's abilities. Okay, so here's what we did. We focused on encouragement in academic STEM contexts, and we wanted to test these predictions during a really important period of academic growth, which is adolescence. So middle and high school students have much more autonomy over their decisions in school, but they often experience setbacks and can easily fall behind. And what this means is that this is a really important period where having meaningful motivational feedback may really matter for them. All right, so what we did is we conducted large-scale online surveys with students across the United States, and we tested our hypothesis in a few different ways. So in one study, what we did is we showed participants several hypothetical scenarios like this. So we told them, let's say that you have a difficult math exam coming up soon, and you're feeling overwhelmed and stressed. And then we asked them, how likely are you to turn to the following people for encouragement? And we also asked them, for each of the following people, how motivated would you be to study for the test if they said, I think you can do it, you got this. So for each of these scenarios, we showed participants four hypothetical speakers who explicitly varied in what they know about the student's abilities and what they know about the math in the student's math class. Okay, and again, the question that we're interested in is whether students would be most likely to seek out and be motivated by a speaker who knows both of these things. Okay, so when we asked students about who they would seek out encouragement from, we found that they provided the highest ratings to a speaker with overlapping knowledge of the domain and of their abilities, more so than a speaker who knows just one or the other, and least for a speaker who knows neither. We saw a very similar pattern for the listening questions, where students say that they would be most motivated by a speaker who knows both of these things. Here's the individual data points if you're curious. And so here what we found is that students reported that they would be most likely to seek out and listen to encouragement from a speaker who knows both about the math in their math class and about their math abilities. So next, what we wanted to do is dig into this effect a bit more and ask, what is underlying this? Why are students seeking out and listening to encouragement from people who are high in both? And one possibility is that students may be more confident in others' encouragement and performance predictions when they're more knowledgeable about both of these. Okay, so to test this possibility in the next study, we actually created a third-person task to more easily manipulate a speaker's knowledge. So we told participants, so today you'll be learning about students at a school. These students have taken four math quizzes so far, and they're about to take another one. There was a big storm at school recently, so a bunch of the students' quiz scores were on the floor. The students helped clean up and saw some of their classmates' scores. Okay, so here's what happened on each trial. We introduced them to two people and said this. Lucy saw one of Avery's four quiz scores. Avery's about to take another quiz, a fifth quiz. Lucy has already taken this quiz and got four of four problems correct. She got all of them right. And Lucy guessed that Avery will also get all of them right. And our question that we asked participants was, how confident are you in Lucy's guess? And so what we did is we parametrically varied the speaker's knowledge about the student's abilities. So speakers may have seen 0 to 4 of the scores, of the student's past scores. And we also varied the speaker's own performance on the quiz scores, on the quiz. So the speaker could have gotten between 0 and 4 points on it. Okay, so that means that there were 25 possible trials in total. And again, the question that we asked participants was, how confident are you in the speaker's guess? And just to clarify here, the speaker always guessed that the student would get all of the problems correct. Okay, so on the x-axis here, we have how many of the students' quizzes were seen. And so first, let's look at what happens when the speaker has no math knowledge, when they got 0 on that quiz. So what you can see here is that the confidence in the speaker's guess increases when they have seen more of the students' quizzes. And you can also see an increase in confidence as math knowledge itself increases. And here what we found is an interaction between math knowledge and ability knowledge such that the effect of ability knowledge is stronger when math knowledge is higher. And so broadly what this suggests to us is that students' confidence in the speaker's estimates increases when the speaker has higher math knowledge and higher ability knowledge. And here what I'm highlighting in green is you can think about these points as the speaker who has high knowledge in both math and the student's math abilities. Okay, so far what we've tested is how students reason about hypothetical people. And in this final study, what we were interested in asking is, well, what about when students think about real people in their lives? Does this effect still hold up? And so in this third and final study, what we did is we asked participants to write down names of their peers, a friend in their math class, another friend outside of math, an older friend or a sibling if they had one. We asked them to think about their parent and also a few different teachers. And our goal in asking about these different people was to capture the spread of math knowledge and ability knowledge across them. Okay, so then participants responded to similar test questions as in study one for each person. They were asked how likely they would be to turn to each of them for encouragement and how motivated they would be given encouragement. And then at the very end of the task, we ask participants to rate each person's math ability knowledge and math knowledge, and then we use these knowledge ratings to then predict participants' responses to the seeking and the listening questions. Okay, so let's think about this before I show you the results. So when it comes to thinking about real people in their lives, students may be thinking about all sorts of things, like how supportive this person is, how kind they are, or they may just generally trust feedback from particular types of people, like their friends or their peers. So it's very possible that in the real world, ability and math knowledge might not predict students' responses to the test questions. But remarkably, we see that they actually do. So after controlling for the participant's relationship to the person, we see that others' knowledge of their math abilities and knowledge of the math in their current math class positively predicted who they would turn to for encouragement and whose encouragement they would actually seek out. And I want to note here that we actually never prompted students to think about each person's knowledge while they were responding to the test questions. We always asked them about knowledge at the very end of the task. Okay, oh, and here are the individual data points, if you're curious, and you can see how highly correlated the knowledge ratings are. So one question that you might be wondering is, well, of all these people, who does have the most overlap on average? And here what I'm going to plot is average ability knowledge ratings on the x-axis and math knowledge ratings on the y-axis. And what you'll see is that the math teacher has the highest ratings on average for both. This is not that surprising given that all of the scenarios are about math. The English teacher has the lowest ratings, and everyone else is somewhere in between. And the important thing to note here is that, again, these types of knowledge seem to be highly correlated. Of all these people, there's not one who clearly has high ability knowledge but low domain knowledge or vice versa. And I think this is really interesting because it could be the case that in the real world, these are just genuinely highly overlapping. And I think this also prompts a really interesting question about to what extent these contents of knowledge are dependent on one another. So for instance, you might think that how much you know about a domain might constrain how well you can know someone's abilities in that domain. And this is a direction that we're interested in looking at in the future. Okay, so let's return to our original prediction here that students would be most likely to seek out and be motivated by encouragement from a speaker with higher domain knowledge and higher ability knowledge. And we found support for this hypothesis across three studies, when others' knowledge was explicitly provided, when we parametrically varied it, and even when students reasoned about real people in their lives. Okay, and an important next question for us is asking how these effects show up in real-world behaviors. How are students' actual learning decisions informed by who provides them with motivational feedback and what that person knows? And more broadly, I think what our findings suggest is that in order to effectively motivate students, it may be really important to pair them with people who know both about the domain and about their abilities. And of course, what this assumes is that there are these people in students' lives, which isn't always the case. And especially as we all get more specialized in what we study, there may be fewer and fewer of these people that are out there for us. And so I think what is a really important question for all of us to think about as mentors and mentees is, well, how can we best build and cultivate environments where students have more access to people who know both? I don't have the answer to this question, but I'll end here and thank my collaborators and you all for listening. And I'm happy to take any questions now.